know, yeah. the rapture, that's yeah. a demonic doctrine.
No.
No, it's not. No. But if you yeah. if you claim to believe in Jesus yeah. and you sit around and do nothing,
yeah.
then you are believing in a demonic doctrine.
Yes.
You're worthless.
You
claim to know Jesus,
Thank you.
But you do nothing.
Yes.
Then where's your faith? Because faith's the verb,
yeah.
and it gets up and goes. And you and I do yeah. not approve
no.
of that kind of theology nor eschatology.
No. Look, you have a new book out.
Yep.
It's called Daze, D-A-Z-E, of Deception. It is selling extremely well. You're very well known. You're kind of a big deal. So I want to talk to you about your book. But first, I want to talk about this controversial thing that I said on my show about what I was interviewing a guest of mine, Benjamin Thomas, about a book he wrote. And I made some statement, not quite realizing what I was saying, and it just went insane. And I heard from you that all these pastors are angry,
yeah.
and we better address it. So what should we
yeah.
do?
Well, let's just do this. I believe that your guest said that those who hold the pre-tribulation rapture view
yeah.
are more prone to sit things out. They don't get engaged. They're just waiting, basically, for Jesus to return. So they don't run for Congress. They
right.
don't
right.
run for mayor. They don't really advance in life. In fact, if the rapture is going to happen, don't go to college.
Right.
And so a lot of pastors got a hold of me and said, Jack, you know Eric. What the heck is he saying?
Yeah.
Because we are running for Congress.
Right.
We do clean the streets, and we are getting our doctorates. And
no,
so,
it was very sloppy of me. You know what the thing is? My default mode is I always kind of agree with my guests, and I'm kind of like a cheerleader. So I wasn't saying, well, now, wait a minute, let's be clear. There are many people with that, you know, eschatology who are as involved as anyone, like my friend Jack Hibbs, for example, and who are preaching that we need to be involved and we need to, but I didn't say that. And I just kind of let it ride, giving the impression that everybody who holds to that view of the end times is not interested in doing what I think we need to do.
Yeah.
And so that was a mistake. But I had no idea
yeah.
how many people would just be like, whoa.
Well, and let's you and I as friends, we happen to be on camera right now.
What
we can just do is pivot and make it good. Because number
I thought
one,
we just did, Jack.
Jesus taught that he was going to come back. You need
yeah.
to be ready for him to come back.
Yes.
Be watchful.
Right.
And that Paul said it's the blessed hope
right.
of his imminent return.
Right.
And a lot of people who do not know accurate eschatology.
Right.
And your gentleman mentioned the escape. I think he called it the rescue rapture.
Right.
When in reality, to just make a correction for all of our brothers and sisters out there,
yeah.
in Luke 21:36, Jesus described all of the horrific things that are coming
yes.
upon the world. And then he said in Luke 21:36, but you pray, therefore, that you might be found worthy to escape all of these things that are coming upon the earth to try those in the world.
Right.
Coupled with John 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go now to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also.
Yeah.
So that is a rapture verse. And
right.
then ultimately, Paul's writing to the Thessalonians regarding the famous rapture passage, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, where not everyone's going to die. At some point in time, he said there's going to be a trumpet blast.
In the twinkling of an eye.
In the twinkling of an eye.
We shall all be changed.
We shall be changed. 1 Corinthians 15. Here's the thing. Some people understood you to be thinking, or that your guest was
yeah.
promoting, if you believe in the rapture, these guys are kind of worthless because they sit around and do nothing.
Right.
And I want to say this for the record. I want to
yeah.
use your platform to
yeah.
say, Eric, you know me. We have members of Congress in our church.
Right.
We have assemblymen, police chief, mayors. We've got actors. We've had a couple of rappers show up. These people are involved in their world, but
yeah.
they love the Lord and they believe Jesus is coming back. Listen, at any time.
Yeah.
So because that's true, we are very, very diligent about being busy about our Father's business.
Right.
So you say, Jack, you got to be crazy. Wait, you believe Jesus is coming back, but you're at NRB with Eric? Yep. But also this, I believe Jesus is coming back. That's why I'm encouraging people to register to vote and, in fact, run for local office.
What is the name of the program that you've set up to
Well, we have several, but you're talking about realimpact.us.
Okay.
Real
this,
impact.
We talked about
it
on the program
it's
before,
epic.
But I got so excited about this because you're doing when I wrote my book
letter... We're doing the Bonhoeffer stuff.
No, I know. When I wrote my book letter to the American church to exhort people to get involved, what you're doing at your church, to me, it's like the flagship of this in America.
I have to say.
So say it again. It's Real Impact.
It's realimpact.us.
Yeah.
And it's anybody from anywhere in the U.S. can log into that and find out what to do. But it's all about shining the light of the gospel and affecting the culture. C.S. Lewis, you're a great fan of C.S. Lewis. A.W. Tozer, they all agree that those who had heaven in mind were the most effective on earth. And
we should be. That's the point. I think my guest on that program was talking about people who twist that and others who misapply the pre-trib idea. And so I was agreeing with him about how it's bad is if you misapply it.
Yeah.
Not if you hold to that view, but if you misapply the view.
Yeah.
And a lot of people misunderstood it.
So can we bury it right here for everybody?
I hope
Some people confused it as, the rapture, that's a demonic doctrine.
No.
No, it's not.
No.
But if you claim to believe in Jesus and you sit around and do nothing...
Yeah.
Then you are believing in a demonic doctrine.
Yes.
You're worthless.
You
claim to know Jesus, but you do nothing.
Yes.
Then where's your faith? Because faith's the verb, and it gets up and goes. And you and I do not approve of that kind of theology nor eschatology.
No, that is really that is a demonic doctrine. Thank you very much.
Well, I love you. And that's
I appreciate
why,
that. Well, it's important. It's just so funny because when you're talking, I think what happens if you're doing a show, you become freer and freer. You're not really thinking sometimes about how people might take what you say. So that was one of those weird situations. But in any event, thanks for helping me clarify it.
Well, only because I love the Eric Metaxas.
I love thee back, my friend. So I want to talk to you about your book now. Now, what is the name of your church? I say to people all around the country, if you're going to a church that is not... alive to where we are in this moment, that is just kind of like quote-unquote preaching the gospel and ignoring the evil that is rising around us and is not standing against the evil and working against it and doing what we can. Just like if the slave trade were happening, Wilberforce called believers to stand against this.
Amen.
Not just say just do church and the slave trade is something we have to live with. Like, no, we're, as believers, we're called to stand against it and politically to shut it down. And politically to shut down slavery. Obviously, in the 19th century in this country, we shut that down. There were, people who believed, had a moral conviction coming out of Scripture that we need to... We're supposed to be actively engaged. And I say to people, if you're going to a church that doesn't get this, get out of that church.
I agree.
But if they say, well, where should I go? I say, well, you should watch Jack Hibbs until while you're finding a local church. I'm serious. I say you should go online and watch my friend Pastor Jack Hibbs. And I know there are tons of people that watch you every Sunday. And so if people do want to find you, where do they go to look? I want to say this right out of the gate. Where do they find you online?
It's very simple because from this location, you can go everywhere. It's jackhibbs.com. Jackhibbs.com will take you to our church services, the Real Life Network, podcasting, various special programming.
Yeah.
Simplest way, jackhibbs.com.
Okay.
And from there, you can go everywhere.
Okay. Got it? Good. All right. So I want to talk to you about the book.
Yep.
Is this the first book you wrote? No.
No, it's not. But the other one did so poorly that nobody really knows we wrote it. Lisa and I wrote a book some years ago with David C. Cook Publishing called Turnaround at Home, Leaving a Better Spiritual Legacy Than What You Received. So in that first book, I came from a non-Christian home, non-Christian background. Lisa came from a very Christian background, very Christian home. And lo and behold, 45, 46 years later, here we are still married with these two crazy backgrounds. But the point is Jesus, no matter what you've come from, she came from legalism, and I came from, let's live it up.
Yeah.
And but God brought us together, and that book explains what God did in our lives and how you can make your life count for Christ as well, your marriage, your family. So, but yeah, this book, Living in the Days of Deception, actually, Eric, came out of the COVID era where I saw what was going on, as you did, and... I did a teaching series on that title. It was Living in the Days of Deception. So I covered deception
within
the...
But living in the D-A-Z-E.
Thank you.
Days of Deception. Just to be clear.
That's
days
right. Thank you. D-A-Z-E. Because everybody then and now feels like they've been smacked like a cartoon.
Yeah.
You can see the little stars and the moons going around people's heads. They feel like they're in a fog or they got smacked. And so I just took a handful of topics. days of deception regarding Israel existing as a nation, regarding church doctrines, regarding marriage, days of deception regarding this gender fluidity issue. I took these issues, applied it from the scripture, and it's not only for the believer, it's for the non-believer also. And I think that's why it's resonated. I mean, our sales, according to the publisher, it's been their top book that they've done, and we're grateful for that. But here's the reason why. People feel confused. They feel like they're in a daze. And so we're blessed by Secretary Mike Pompeo having written the foreword, and it's doing well.
Well, it's so interesting because I resonate with you so deeply that it's hard for me to even think. Like, I want to. But before I met you, before I knew about you and your church in Chino Hills, mm-hmm. California, I had heard about you because you were one of those few pastors that knew when COVID hit and everybody's saying, we've got to shut the churches down, you pretty quickly said, no.
Right.
And that was a big deal because there was this deception out there that, oh, to be a Christian is just to go along with the government to tell you that's the Christ-like thing to do, which it can be.
It can be.
And it can also not be. And you had the discernment to say, no, we're going to open up our church. And when I spoke at your church, I don't know when it was, but it was it blew my mind. I walk out on the stage and I see thousands of people without masks, and I thought, this is so delightfully normal. It's insane. I've never seen, this is incredible. Like, you're just doing church, like, you know.
Right.
And of course, in retrospect, that was exactly right.
Yeah.
But at the time, you and your church, you're being vilified as super spreaders. Our friend Sean Foyt is being vilified as a super spreader. So what was it at that time that made you see this is deception?
Yeah.
We're going to keep our church open. And I want to be clear, because you did the right thing, tons of people found you and said, who's this guy? We want to go to that church. We're interested in somebody who is being brave and whatever. And any pastor that was brave at that time, their churches have exploded. The numbers
have
exploded. And
that's
and those who were timid are struggling to keep. Well, I mean, it's amazing.
That's a fact. Eric, thank you. And listen, I can't take all the credit because when we decided to just go full bore, it should be known to everybody that in California, I invited from our pastors' network, these are Baptists, Lutherans, Calvary Chapel, Methodists, doesn't matter. I asked them, will you open up your church? Will you stand? We're going to go forward with or without you guys, but listen, 1,200 pastors opened up their church on that day that we did as well in the state of California,
mind you.
A lot of people don't know that. That never hit the press.
Yeah.
So here's the thing, you guys, is that it came down to this. The Lord spoke to my heart. Look, I didn't hear rumbling. My roof didn't blow off my house. I didn't hear an audible voice. But what he said to my soul was immediately this. Jack, I've set before you an open door that no man can shut. So I picked up the phone, I called our entire staff, and I said, we're opening, and you're going to get...
What was the date, like roughly?
April 26th is
2020?
Yeah, is when I heard God speak.
No, but I'm saying, like, this is a big deal. This is right at the beginning of the COVID stuff, and you're praying, and you believe that
he
the
made
Lord
it clear.
Speaks to you through the scripture to open your church very early on.
Yep.
And you obey the Lord... And you open up your church,
and
you got all these other pastors to open up their churches.
That's right.
But that's so huge, because pastors all across the country were shutting down their churches.
This,
I know pastors that shut down the church for a year and a half.
I know who you're talking about. And by the way,
I don't get it.
Both of those churches, or at least both of those churches, are pretty much done now.
It's actually, I mean, it's kind of Romans 8:28, right?
Yeah.
All things work together for good. Even COVID pandemic, the Lord can use that for his purposes. And what he did in that time and has done ever since is that directed believers to churches that they didn't know about.
That's right.
Like your church. And they kind of thought, hey, this is great. I'm going to stay here. They got kind of planted there. And by the time their old church opened up, they were like, you know, I'm done with that.
That's exactly correct.
And so it's kind of the free market working together for good, right? Where people chose something that works better for them, and they've decided to stay there.
Well, not only, Eric, everything yes to that, but what a lot of people don't realize is that there were many people who, like you just said, hey, my church has been closed. I'm going to go over there and see what's going on at this place, where I'm meeting them after service and they're telling me, I've been here for 3 weeks now. I've been here for 5 weeks now. Yeah. Pastor, did I hear you correct? Did you say that I must be born again to enter the kingdom of heaven? And I said, I actually didn't say that. Jesus said it. You heard me repeat Jesus.
Yeah.
Well, I've never heard that before at my church. Eric, three Saturdays, we baptized 3,011 people in three Saturdays. People making decisions out of COVID. God may not have sent COVID, but he'll use it.
You know,
he'll use anything.
This is like the beginning of the third great awakening. I'm not exaggerating. This is that when the history is written of how it all started, how this revival started.
It could be.
That's how, I'm just telling you that that's, if it hadn't been for COVID, if it hadn't been for all these other churches timidly shutting down, all of these people who were not hearing the gospel or who were not they were not hearing something that they now began to hear, and they decided, yeah, I'm going to go with that. If it hadn't been for that, these people, so there are tons and tons of people. This is called evangelism, except it wasn't your plan, it wasn't my plan,
right.
It was the Lord's plan.
Right.
And a lot of people are planted and solid and going to churches like yours and getting fed in a way they were not getting fed before all of this went
down.
So this is good stuff. And the news is not reporting on this.
No.
I'm reporting on it.
The news is not reporting on it.
Of course they're not.
No, you know what? Believe it or not, when we did those baptisms, we got a phone call from one of our missionaries in Turkey. And Turkey had aired it on their national news program in Turkey. And it was very well, it was in favor of what was happening. People didn't know this in the States. They had no idea. It wasn't getting covered. So,
there's a lot of news. I mean, this is kind of interesting. There's a lot going on that'll never get covered in the news. If you're not following the right people, you're just not going to hear about what's actually happening. And it's kind of fascinating because the cultural elites, right, these global leaders, and they themselves don't know about what is happening. God, it's like an underground fire going and going and going and going. They're oblivious to what is happening. And when it explodes, into reality where people can actually see it, they're going to be stunned. Where did this come from?
Yes.
What is happening? That's what's happening. It's happening now.
So let's break this on your program. Okay, so who reported this? That when Gavin Newsom said that 501c3s in the state of California, nonprofit organizations, will have to pay for elective abortions, Gavin Newsom's office, we are not acknowledging the Supreme Court's decision that was made by the Hobby Lobby case. Well, I said, we're not going to fund elective abortions.
Right.
We lost our insurance coverage. At the same time, we sued the governor's office.
What? Haven't you read Romans 13? What is wrong with you, Pastor Jack Hibbs?
Exactly.
Suing the governor's office.
Exactly. You know what I did?
Holy
I appealed to Caesar. That's what I did. I practiced Paul's appealing to Caesar.
Oh, yeah. There's that passage also in the
also,
New Testament.
Also, there comes a time when it's better to obey God rather than man. And lo and behold, the beautiful people at ADF, we beat the governor's office. We won that case, and it was not reported on one news outlet whatsoever. And I just want everybody to know that for California, 501c3s longer have to pay for their insurance abortions because that was overturned by
Pastor Jack Hibbs being an actual leader. And also, we're raising money on my program for the Alliance Defending Freedom. A lot of people don't realize
they are
heroes.
Absolutely.
When you are in trouble and you say, we've got to go, we've got to fight this legally, we're going to appeal to Caesar, quote unquote, where do you turn? The Alliance Defending Freedom. Total heroes.
100%.
And totally funded by people like folks listening to this program. They are total heroes. Now, if it weren't for the Alliance Defending Freedom, where would you go? How do you find somebody to fight this who has the conviction to say, you're right, we want to fight with you? So I just want to give a shout out anytime I get to the Alliance Defending Freedom, because what you did, Pastor Che On got involved also in California. A number of California pastors really showed a level of leadership that is staggering to me. And you're at the head of it, our friend Rob McCoy.
Right.
And they basically said, we know what the scripture says.
That's right.
We know that Governor Newsom, you can't tell us
to
do
that.
And therefore, we won't do it. We refuse to do it. But so many pastors said, oh, you know, you shouldn't do that. That's a bad witness going against the government. I mean, but don't you find it interesting how many pastors and how many Christian leaders across America got this wrong?
You know what?
It breaks my heart.
For them, it's an easy or convenient read of the scripture. When you read, they all cited Romans 13, but they didn't read it very well. It says that God has put those authorities in power to do good. Listen, when Gavin Newsom decided not to do good,
yeah,
then that's clearly an indicator that the mantle of God's authority is off of his shoulders.
Yeah.
Do I respect the office of the governor?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But when somebody takes that authority and prostitutes it, then he's no longer worthy of that position. So we said to him, it's better for us to obey God now rather than man. And by the way, this is going to be going on more and more in our America today.
Yeah.
And again, God turns it around for good. Pastors are going to be, I believe, divinely called out to take a stand, to go against the grain, because we are in our Bonhoeffer moment. Your letter to the American church, you know that the moment I read it, I was shouting this book out to everybody in the world. You got to get this book.
Well, look, I so appreciate that you had a pastor's conference and you made it possible. Because, I mean, I think we have to realize that the way information travels, a lot of people, you know, you can put something out. It's happened to me. You put it out there, but people don't hear about it. The people you thought would hear about it don't hear about it. And so this message that we're living in this moment right now, that where the American church is parallel to where the German church was under Hitler in the first years of Hitler, not at the end, but in the first years, before most people knew where it was going. In fact, almost nobody knew where it was going.
Mm.
But Bonhoeffer and others said, we need to take a prophetic stand against the wickedness of the Nazis. And everybody today says, well, of course. No. In 1933, 34, most Christians and Christian leaders and pastors in Germany did not get it.
They didn't get it.
And so Bonhoeffer and others were trying to get them to get it and saying, God is saying we need to band together and stand against this evil. And because they didn't do it, the German church dithered and dithered and dithered, and then suddenly the Nazis had total control. So what you just did with Gavin Newsom, with Governor, a few years from now, if it weren't for pastors like you, you might not be able to do that. It might be too late. In other words, we've had a window of opportunity to push back. We're in that window right now. The window is shutting down. And if pastors are not heroically standing against these evils, in no time, if you say, oh, yeah, we want to stand against this evil, it's going to be, well, too bad. You should have stood a year ago when Jack Hibbs and others were standing. It is now too late.
So, Eric, again, breaking now on your show right now is this reality that I was just reminded of by Speaker Mike Johnson, Speaker of the House.
Yes.
A lot of people don't realize that in the 2022 election, that the reason why Nancy Pelosi was fired from Congress and the Republicans, pro-life Republicans, took control of Congress.
Yes, I know this. Go ahead.
Do you know where I'm going with this?
Yes.
People are not talking about the fact that California changed congressional seats for pro-life more than any other state. That's how it became a Republican Congress, a pro-life Congress.
Yeah.
And I was just with Mike Johnson a week and a half ago, and he is very aware that California actually put him in that seat.
Yeah.
But who's talking about it?
Nobody's talking about it. The Democrats cannot lose
their darling California, but they're losing it.
Yeah.
They're losing California.
Well, this gets back to the beginning of our conversation. You and others have taken the lead in getting Christians to understand they must be politically active. They must get involved. If you don't get involved, the other side, the dark side, the Gavin Newsom side, they are involved.
Oh, they're in.
And
they're all in.
They are pushing a satanic agenda, trying to force churches to pay for killing babies in the womb. And if Christians don't get involved in this stuff, if pastors don't exhort their flocks to get involved, to run for office, to vote, to be poll watchers, to do all this different stuff, we lose everything that we've had. So you took the lead on this. Now, what is the website of the thing that you started?
Impact? RealImpact.us.
Okay. I hope everybody listening will go to RealImpact.us. This is a model for churches. I mean, this is the outworking of what I write about. I write the theory in my book, Letter to the American Church, and the film, Letter to the American Church. But then people say, what do I do? go to realimpact.us, realimpact.us. I beg you, folks, go to realimpact.us, because you have set up the way actually for churches to do this.
To do it.
And you did it in California. And because you did it, I want to be clear, because you did this, what you just said, enough Congress people were elected with our values to flip the Congress.
That's right.
To make it possible for us to have a conservative speaker, Mike Johnson, be the Speaker of the House. It's an amazing thing. And as you just said, nobody's talking. The news is not talking about this. That California.
They don't want to bring it up.
It's kind of amazing.
They're trembling right now. In fact, for the first time, I'm not sure if it was David Barton or George Barna had said, for the first time in decades, the Democrat Party's now pouring money into California because they're losing seats. But
I've read all your books.
John Tesh from the 80s? He's still here.
We
sing. Helped me get healed.
We sing your songs.
Oh my gosh!
Don't tell him.
Are you guys on the air?
Great John Tesh.
Just technically. Just technically.
Oh, that's awesome.
Go get your keyboard. All right, now listen. That was. What's going on around here? This is incredible.
Amazing.
It's John
what
Tesh.
A talent.
I know, and he's a big guy. We used to be that big. So Jack, what were we talking about? This is the problem with NRB.
Here,
it's the joy and the problem.
Ask me how those seats were flipped.
Okay. How were those seats flipped, Jack?
Well,
Hibbs?
California passed a really dumb law called ballot harvesting that the world was shocked to hear
ballot
about.
Ballot harvesting?
Yeah.
Isn't that an invitation to cheating? And isn't cheating wrong?
Exactly. It's so wrong.
What?
And it became the law which enshrined the abortion doctrine of the Democrat Party forever in California.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what we did is we got a hold of the guys at ADF and other places. They read the law and they said, why are you asking us? And I said, because if it's the law, then we want to do it right. We're going to call it ballot collection. We're going to mobilize every church in California to do it right. And we're going to video record. We're going to do it perfectly. Here's what happened, Eric, starting with Mike Garcia for Congress, Young Kim, Michelle Steele, Daryl Issa. These guys won their seats. The Democrat Party threatened to sue us. They came to check it out. ABC News, Fox, everybody came. They looked at what we were doing on a Sunday afternoon, and they said there's no story here. The Democrat Party walked away.
Yeah.
We beat them at their game. We did it better than they did, and that's how it happened.
I got to tell you, what you did, I mean, this should be headline news across America. And I want to say to folks, I'm not exaggerating. This should be headline news across America that Christians, politically activated Christians, made it possible for us to flip the House and to do anything that we do in the House that is good is because of
California.
Jack Hibbs and realimpact.us. And I want to say, folks, if there's people saying, well, what can I do? After you go to realimpact.us, I'm not kidding, go to my website, my radio website, metaxastalk.com. Why? Because we have a banner for the Alliance Defending Freedom. We're trying to raise money for them. Please, when people say, what can I do? Go to metaxastalk.com. You'll see the banner for the Alliance Defending Freedom. Please give something, because they are total heroes.
Yes.
And without them, none of this stuff could have happened.
Wouldn't
and
have
this
happened.
Is amazing. So praise the Lord for the Alliance Defending Freedom.
Amen.
Praise the Lord for you and all the pastors that got involved in this.